Hello everyone, I am Dr. Savan Giridhar Dharmapurivar, Associate Professor, Department of English, Vidyasagar Kala Mahavidyalay, Khairi Vijayawada, Ramtek. Today, we are going to learn the topic, the dramatic devices. In order to present the play more effectively on the stage, the dramatist uses certain devices known as the dramatic devices. In this lecture, we are going to discuss about these dramatic devices. While taking the definition or meaning of the dramatic devices, we can say that the dramatic devices are the devices or the tricks employed by the dramatist to make the play more interesting. I will once again repeat. The dramatic devices are the devices or tricks employed by the dramatist to make the play more interesting. The dramatic devices, those we are going to discuss in this lecture, are as follows: the dramatic irony, soliloquy and aside, expectation and surprise, and the last one will be stage directions. So let us learn about them one by one. The dramatic irony is a form of contrast. Often it happens that what is said on the stage has two meanings. The first meaning is for the characters in the play, while the second meaning, much wider than the first, is for the audience. This device on the part of the dramatist, which produces two point of views or meanings, is called as the dramatic irony. In this device, the audience know more than the characters in the play. The dramatic irony is of two types. The first one is irony of dialogue. It is also called as verbal irony. And the second one is irony of situation. So let us learn about the irony of dialogue or the verbal irony. As the name suggests, if the irony arises out of what is said or spoken on the stage, is known as the irony of dialogue or the verbal irony. In the plays of William Shakespeare, we get ample examples of the dramatic irony of dialogue. In Twelfth Night, when we see Viola speaking with the Duke in the gaze of a page, we have an example of irony of dialogue. The audience knew that the character of Page is actually Viola, but Duke is unknown with this. The same example we find in the play As You Like It, when we see Rosalind speaking to Orlando in the gaze of a shepherd. So these are the finest example from the plays of William Shakespeare, which present the dramatic irony, verbal irony before us. Sorry, which presents irony of dialogue or the verbal irony before us. The second type of the dramatic irony is irony of situation. The irony of situation arises out of situation in the play. The irony of situation arises out of action or what is done on the stage. William Shakespeare's Macbeth furnishes with many examples of dramatic irony of situation in which circumstances convey opposite meanings, and some of the notable examples can be given from the play Macbeth. The first example can be given from Macbeth is Macbeth's meeting with the witches after Banquo's death, when he speaks with the witches and witches tell him about his future. So that is the finest example of dramatic irony of situation. And second one is King Duncan's visit to Macbeth's castle, that he is going to stay there. He's going for the sake of what we get from the invitation from Lady Macbeth, and he thinks that he's going to rest and enjoy there. But we, or the audience, actually know that what is going, what bad can happen over there. So that's why King Duncan's visit to Macbeth's castle and the porter scene in the play. The tragedies of Greek masters are generally full of what we can say ironic situations, and those dramatists make fine use of the dramatic devices, the dramatic irony. They use both the drama, irony of dialogue and irony of situation while presenting, while writing their plays. So after learning about the dramatic irony, we will move on to the topic. Next dramatic device, that is stage directions. So what are the stage directions? In order to present the play exactly as the writer desires, he gives stage directions in the script of the play. Stage directions are not proper dramatic devices. They are, because they are never addressed to the audience. But why we are learning those stage directions as dramatic devices? Because in order to present the play exactly as the writer desires, or the dramatist desires, he gives certain hints or direction in the script of the play. And with the help of those hints, with the help of those directions, it is supposed that the producer should create his plays, or producer should properly present that play on the stage. So that's why I'm saying that whatever the hints, whatever the directions which are given by the dramatist in the script of the play, those directions, those hints are known as stage directions. Stage directions are not proper dramatic devices in true sense. They are, because they are never addressed to the audience. They are just like some hints or suggestions. They are meant for the producer or the director of the play and not for the audience. They act like useful guidelines while presenting that play on the stage. It is expected that the producer or the director of the play should go through these guidelines and present the play without any mistake, without any fault. In absence of stage directions, the producer or a director may commit some error, may commit some mistakes while producing or presenting the play on the stage. And all this all can be avoided if the producer or director follows the stage directions which are given in the script of the play by the dramatist, by the writer. William Shakespeare was in favor of stage directions. The stage directions given by Shakespeare are very brief. They tell us about the scene and the characters who are to appear in the act or the scene. At the same time, the dramatists like Barry, George Bernard Shaw provide us with the detailed stage directions. George Bernard Shaw also gives a long and lengthy preface to each of his plays and discusses frankly the moral, social, religious and political problems of the day to have better understanding of the play. So this is all about the stage directions. Our next dramatic device is the soliloquy. Soliloquy is a dramatic device. In this device, there is generally a single character on the stage. He acquaints the audience with what is passing in his mind. It is therefore an actor's secret thoughts uttered aloud on the stage. It is, however, supposed to be heard by nobody. It is generally spoken when no other actor is present on the stage. It is just like an expression of oneself. It has got an honorable place in English literature. Many dramas are filled with many fine soliloquies. The greatest name in this field is of once again William Shakespeare. His dramas, his plays, his tragedies like Macbeth, Othello, King Lear and Hamlet offer us with world famous soliloquies, and they have brought him immortal fame as dramatist. Some critics have also criticized soliloquy, calling it an unnatural device. They say that soliloquy is kind of unnatural device. It should not be used in dramas, but still soliloquy's importance from the dramatic point of view cannot be denied. Now we shall learn about the topic which is related with the soliloquy, and the title of the topic is aside. Aside means a brief comment made by one character in the presence of other characters on the stage, but they are not expected to hear it. Once again, I will, what we can say, repeat the same. What is aside? Aside, the meaning of aside. Aside means a brief comment that has been made by one character in the presence of other characters on the stage, but those characters who are present on the stage, they are not expected to hear that particular comment. Generally, it is a passing thought full of psychological trait of the speaker. In other words, aside is a shortest form of the soliloquy and serves a like purpose. Both soliloquy and aside were much in favor till the end of the 18th century. Dramatists were regularly using soliloquies and aside while writing their plays, while writing their dramas. But after that, they started to decline, for the drama has tended to be more and more natural and realistic. But what happens? But it seems nowadays, in modern days, soliloquies and aside have once again came in favor in the form of the daily soaps and serials on television. So this is all about the topics soliloquy and aside. Our next dramatic devices that we are going to learn are expectation and surprise. Expectation and surprise are generally studied together. They are often employed in the play to heighten the curiosity of the audience, to what we can say sustain, to heighten the curiosity of the audience in the play. These two devices are used in the drama, and they are generally used by the dramatists together. In the first device of expectation, what the dramatist does? So in the first device of expectation, the audience get what they expect. For example, in a Hindi movie, climax, we see that the villain has captured and tied hero's mother and heroine and his relatives in his so-called adda or the place. And the audience expects that hero will come and rescue them from the clutches of the villain. The writer creates such circumstances that the hero faces many barriers, many problems to reach there. And at last, the hero comes breaking some big wall and gives a fine beating to villain and gunda people and rescues his family. The audience becomes happy that the film ended according to their expectations. So this is how the dramatic device of expectation is used by the writer, used by the dramatist to heighten the curiosity of the, to heighten and sustain the curiosity of the audience in his plays. The second device, which is related with expectation, or rather which is used together with the expectation. In the second device of expectation, in the second device of surprise, the dramatist unbelievably and unexpectedly gives a turn or twist to the plot, to a turn or twist to the story, with an intention to surprise the audience. It is just like the Jor Ka Jhatka that has been given by dramatist. Jor Ka Jhatka, dheere se types of turn given by dramatist in the story. The audience which is expecting that story will go in this direction, the film or the drama will end in this particular direction, that has not been fulfilled by the dramatist, fulfilled by the writer, and he gives a sudden twist or the turn and the story or the drama or the plot ends in an unbelievable point. And that has been what we can say surprise given by the dramatist. In short, expectation is the device in which the dramatist puts all his cards open on the table. In surprise, he withholds some information from the audience for some time being, only to put them to surprise. Shakespeare has employed both these devices, the device of expectation, the device of surprise, in his tragedies and in his comedies. We can cite Macbeth and Othello as the finest example of finest examples of the drama which uses the dramatic devices surprise and expectation. William Shakespeare's play Othello is built on expectation, while the drama Macbeth is built on the surprise. So students, this is all about the topic, the dramatic devices, and we have discussed 4 dramatic devices in our lecture: the dramatic irony, stage directions, soliloquy and aside, and expectation and surprise. We have studied soliloquy and aside together, we have studied expectation and surprise together. So this is all about the topic, the dramatic devices. With this, I have come to an end of my discussion on the topic, the dramatic devices. I hope you might have enjoyed this lecture and understood the topic, the dramatic devices. Thank you. Thank you, all of you.